Welcome back to Adobe's Think Tank. I'm Jeff Barrett, and if you haven't seen us before, we're in a giant glass box. Scott Zoldi, Chief Analytics Officer for FICO, is with me. Thank you for joining me.
My pleasure.
Because we don't have a ton of time, and people love like hot predictions, let's get into some of your AI predictions over the next year. Just kind of fun stuff, right?
Yeah, so in the next year, one of the things that we're going to see a lot of in AI is an increased focus on explainability.
Sure.
So, you know, today there are more and more regulations out there that are insisting that we need to have an ability to explain both to ourselves as we build models and to those that use those models and to the regulators that we can explain. And this has generally been a hard problem for artificial intelligence and machine learning.
And we've been kind of getting vague, and it's almost becoming a catch-all, right? So now we have to like define niche inside of niche, right?
Exactly. I think we're going to see a transition away from predictive power to explainability, mm-hmm. and then predictive power, so we can remove the black box around AI and machine learning.
And what does that do then for us? Like, how will that, you know, help AI achieve growth in the next couple of years?
So, you know, in some regulated areas, it means that AI can be used or not used. So if you have the ability to explain it, then you'll get adoption.
Yeah. But
more importantly, more and more of machine learning and AI is coming into our daily lives all the time. And we need to have an ability to explain and understand when it's going to make mistakes. And so I think we're starting to see more and more mainstream use of AI and machine learning, which is great. So now we've got to put the brakes on a little bit and make sure we can explain it, justify it, and have the fail-safes in there.
But like not a hard pump, just like a couple pumps, like if you're in the Midwest and it's winter and you just want to make sure you don't go off the road, right?
Exactly. There's too much momentum. We just don't want to hit the wall at 120. We want to have a little time.
Definitely not at 120. You've talked about AI being operational in the cloud. Can you kind of touch on that and what that means for business?
Yeah, so today, you know, one of the challenges we would have in the past would be getting that data, transferring the data. Right, but with the cloud-based environments, we have so much more from an AI perspective. One, in terms of open source to, you know, explore different sort of machine learning algorithms, but more importantly, to in a cost-effective fashion to bring that data up in the cloud, work with it, experiment with it, use things like Jupyter notebooks and workbenches to explore and prototype and kind of innovate much more rapidly. Whereas in the past, you know, getting the data in one place and buying the infrastructure around it and getting the right tools, it just takes such a long time.
And I mean, those potential cost efficiencies, right? All these things, does that then open up? I mean, AI is not just a big business thing. It can be a small business thing too, but does that then open AI up to everyone and allow, you know, small businesses to kind of compete?
Absolutely. I mean, I think what it means is that you don't have to be a large firm with lots of data scientists. You could be a one or two data scientists with a great idea and then prototype it up on the cloud, right?
Easy open access to data. Do you see a lot more kids then going into AI in the next 5 years?
Absolutely. I mean, I have a lot of people approach me and saying, well, where do I go get like a PhD or advanced learning in machine learning?
Yeah.
And 20 years ago, you know, those things didn't really exist. They were physicists, mathematicians, statisticians. Now it's a big problem still because, you know, a lot of the universities are trying to make sure that they can train people properly. But we're seeing the whole academic curriculums changing in that regard. And a lot of times it's with partnership with corporations that are doing machine learning and AI. And frankly, it's super important because, you know, we need the new scientists to come in with understanding kind of the, how do you build them properly? How do you ensure that you can put the governance around it and you can rely on that?
And it's almost kind of an impending concern 5 years from now. If we do this much with AI, will we have enough people that will, you know, want to do that, go into that field, want to do that? I mean, the dollar figure alone will make a lot of kids want to go in there, but you still have to kind of inspire them. And I think conferences like this can do that. I think the educators that are here, we've got some really good schools here and people talking about that. What made you get in the field?
So I got interested because I originally was doing a PhD in physics. And
yeah.
So I completed that. I studied chaos theory, of all things. And in chaos theory, you have to learn patterns in complex data.
Right.
And so what I ended up doing is I wanted to do something more practical. So I went into the business environment where I worked for the firm FICO, solving business problems. It's the same exact problem. Huge amounts of data, looking for patterns, making predictions. And so that's how I made the transition from physics right directly into machine learning and data science, but applied to business applications.
It's a pretty interesting transition. And tell me a little bit about what you do at FICO and how you apply on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, so I actually run a data science team of machine learning scientists. We have more than 100 there that are focused around developing models for financial crimes, so like credit card fraud, anti-money laundering, cybersecurity. We also have machine learning applied to things like credit risk and credit scores. And so, you know, it's permeating.
It's only becoming
everything.
More and more important right now, right?
It absolutely is, right? And then in addition to that, democratizing the knowledge of kind of what that score is and how could you explain it. So if you think about like the FICO score, right, you can go there on the website, you get the score, and you can understand the reasons why. And that's really important also because that allows, you know, the people that are being, you know, receiving those scores to understand how to improve that over time. And that's a big part of our focus is use machine learning, but make it accessible and explainable so that you can kind of affect that outcome if you want to.
Yeah, and speaking of accessible, you responded to my dumb tweet at 1 in the morning about you can't change my FICO score.
Yeah, it's off awesome. The table, yeah.
Yeah, sure. No. Well, I understand that. I mean, even though we've talked in a glass box, I understand that. Lastly, what advice, because we talked on this for students a little bit, but what advice do you have for people working in the field, kind of pushing this field forward, both from a level of how we promote it, but also how we ethically work in it?
Yeah, so I would encourage collaboration, and like conferences like this, again, are really good for that because it allows best practices to come out and allows people to talk about the problems they're having. It's a complex field. There's a lot of ways to make mistakes in terms of what you build the models and how you deploy them. And so the more that there can be this kind of community of best practices, it means that as we get these advances in AI, and by the way, there's like 2,000 new startup companies in AI right now trying to apply it to new areas.
Decent number.
We need to make sure that they're successful in it. And part of that's through this collaboration of scientists that are just trying to make sure that we develop things properly from a machine learning perspective.
Well, thanks, Scott.
My pleasure, Jeff. Thank you so much.
And follow along with us at hashtag AdobeTT, and also tweet me at 1 in the morning, because I respond, and so does Scott.
You do.